Dominus illuminatione mea. Salus mea qua tenebo. Gloria Patri et Filio et Spiritui Sancto. Sicur erat in principio, et nunc et semper, et in saecula saeculorum. Amen. Ex audi Domine, vocem mea,
thank you. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Leave us not comfortless, but send to us thine Holy Ghost to comfort us, and exalt us unto the same place whither our Savior Christ is gone before, who liveth and reigneth with thee, and the same Holy Ghost, one God, world without end.
Amen.
You may be seated for readings.
First reading is from the Acts of the Apostles. In those days, Peter stood up among the believers, and together the crowd numbered about 120 persons, and said, "Friends, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit through David foretold concerning Jesus, who became a guide for those who arrested Jesus. For he was numbered among us, and was allotted his share in this ministry. So one of the men who had accompanied us during all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John until the day when he was taken up from us. One of these must become a witness with us to his resurrection. So they proposed two: Joseph, called Barsabbas, who was also known as Justice, and Matthias. Then they prayed and said, "Lord, you know everyone's heart. Show us which one of these two you have chosen to take the place in this ministry and apostleship from which Judas turned aside to go to his own place." And they cast lots for them, and the lot fell on Matthias, and he was added to the 11 apostles. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Concerning this. And this is the testimony: God gave us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Disciples, saying, "I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you, for the words that you gave to me, I have given to them, and they have received them and know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I am not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine. And I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one, as we are one. While I was with them, I protected them in your name that you have given me. I guarded them, and not one of them was lost, except the one destined to be lost, so that the scripture might be fulfilled. But now I am coming to you, and I speak these things in the world, so that they may have joy, and my joy made complete in themselves. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them, because they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. I am not asking you to take them out of the world, but I ask you to protect them from the evil one. They do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. Sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. As you have sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. And for their sakes, I sanctify myself, so that they also may be sanctified in truth. The Gospel of the Lord. Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please be seated. My friends, I think it is fair to say that the entire corpus of the Christian faith started with storytelling. Well, as we heard from our lessons today, that Jesus is now about to entrust his sacred stories to the disciples. And in those days as well, faith was transmitted through oral tradition. Yes, there were some scrolls, Dead Sea Scrolls, but it's not something that everybody could have access to easily. So by and large, the faith was spread by oral tradition. And the stories we have in the New Testament as well, they were gathered through oral traditions and finally codified as a text we have today. So stories, storytelling, spread from one place to another. And we could actually even say that, you know, even outside of our faith, right? The storytelling itself is a human experience, and it's a unique hallmark and characteristic of humanity. Yeah, because we don't know of any other creatures on earth that will tell stories, right? And then in terms of storytelling, it's that we go through different stages. Children especially enjoy having adults read stories to them, and they also kind of mimic our storytelling and try to tell us different things. Reading or telling a story to a child is a bonding experience between the participants. My son is 8 years old, and we still have this nighttime routine of reading bedtime stories, but he also has assignments where he would read back to me, and then I'll correct some of the readings, but for comprehension and all that. And children do not merely listen passively as well to a story, because they also engage in that experience on many levels, and they will think about different things, and it ignites their imagination, their intellect and emotions. So storytelling really changes us in positive ways. While, you know, maybe we don't necessarily want to have a story read to us as much these days, we still like reading them, hearing them. Storytelling retains in adulthood the same interests and benefits as we find in childhood, because good stories truly inspire our imagination and can win our attention. Stories can teach us important concepts. They build and nurture relationships, and among friends new and old, at family gatherings, or even at lunch or at work, sharing and recalling stories, even those we've heard 100 times before, can strengthen our bonds of fellowship. But the opposite is also true, and what is more destructive to fellowship than gossip and rumor mongering, especially without any fact checking. In addition, we may sometimes regard those who don't have interesting stories to tell as boring, reclusive, and those who have too much to tell, a gazillion stories to tell, as too self-centered and self-absorbed. So, right, moderation is the key here, I guess. So, storytelling of the appropriate kind and quantity is essential for building relationships and witnessing for the causes we believe in. The spread of the Christian faith started with storytelling. The apostles and the other witnesses of Christ's ministry started telling us the stories of Jesus Christ soon after his death, resurrection, and ascension. And some of these stories are handed down to us in the New Testament. Others remain in an apocryphal status or have been lost altogether. St. John, for example, says in the 20th chapter of his gospel, today we heard from the 17th chapter, so we fast forward a little bit, we'll have this. Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, meaning the Gospel of John. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. The stories of Jesus that St. John has written are meant to convince us that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God. And his further hope is that through believing that Jesus is the Messiah, we may truly have life in his name, eternal life in Christ's name. And John further develops his storytelling in his letter to his community of Christians, sometimes called the Johannine community, to whom his 3 pastoral epistles, 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, were initially directed. And we heard today, if we receive human testimony, the testimony of God is greater. For this is the testimony of God, that he has testified to his Son. The term used here for testimony is martyria in the Greek original, which means witness, giving or telling evidence. And we have derived the word martyr from this word for witness. A martyr is literally someone who gave up their life for the sake of testifying to the truth of Jesus Christ. Martyrs give up their lives for the sake of the life-giving storytelling of the life and work of Jesus Christ. The point that St. John makes here is that humans can tell stories and give testimonies, but the testimony and story that God tells through his Son, which then in turn get passed on through the apostles to us, is of much greater significance for us. So, in a sense, the testimony of God, God giving testimony, is not direct, not so much like what we heard in Exodus when Moses went up the mountain, right, to receive the tablets for the Ten Commandments in that scenario. But this is transmitted through storytelling. God telling Jesus and Jesus telling disciples and us. Therefore, he emphasizes again in the epistle, as he did in the gospel bearing his name, I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life. So this is fleshed out even more now, right? Because in the gospel is, you know, so that they may have life. And in the epistle, John finally puts this concept of eternal life into the mix. These things, I write these things to you. By these things, St. John means that the stories, these are the stories about Jesus Christ, the testimonies he gives through the gospel and the epistles. The weaving together of these stories and testimonies is the most reliable information, curriculum vitae, CV, if you will, of Christ, the Son of God. St. John and the other evangelists, Mark, Matthew, and Luke, present to us truly the greatest story ever told. And we are meant to engage with this story, to grow in our faith, in our intellect, and in our imagination, in our bonds with one another, and in our journey to Christ together. So my friends, the good news of God in Jesus Christ is truly a gift that keeps on giving. Following the footsteps of the apostles, witnesses to Christ's ministry, martyrs and saints of the church in all times, following them, we are called to model after their testimony and storytelling in our own day, in our own way. There are stories in the Bible that resonate with us, and we often retell in our own ways and how that may relate to our life events. But most people may not, that we come into contact with, may not be too interested in an exposition of, or in a form of a sermon that we would give to them about what they think about scriptures. But, you know, of course, if they are so inclined, they're always welcome to come here. But seriously, most folks we come across are more likely to be interested in why we have this faith and how that faith has changed our lives for the better and the lives of those around us. What impact has your faith in Christ made in your lives? And with Christ in your heart on your side, do you now face life with more hope, more serenity, and more love? Has your faith made you a better person, meaning less judgmental and more loving? Have you been able to enjoy more certainty about the hope of the future, even amidst the current ups and downs in life and in world events? And for me personally, one of the stories I often would tell, how I learned about the importance of the ministry of presence in the church, ministry of presence, that our being together in worship. It's when I tell a story of a time when my father passed away prematurely, quite some years ago now. My father made few friends in his life, and mostly has stayed away from church most of his life, despite his early baptism and also brief instructions he received in Sunday school when he was little. So my mother and I wonder how many people would actually show up for the funeral. But the kind Christians at my mother's church showed up in droves to support and comfort us amidst our grief and loss, even though they barely knew him. That was the first time I vividly experienced what we call the ministry of presence. Time is a gift that many of us in our hectic lives seem to have a scarcity of. And by taking the time and being present at this important moment in my family's life, those who came made the healing power of the Church of God palpable and tangible for my mother and myself, just as Jesus said of his disciples, "By their fruits you will know them. By their fruits you will know them." And it was St. Teresa of Avila who once said, "Christ is no body on earth now but yours, no hands but yours, no feet but yours. Yours are the eyes through which the compassion of Christ must look out on the world. Yours are the feet with which he is to go about doing good. Yours are the hands with which he is to bless his people." And my friends, I believe that's ultimately the most important reason why we must continue to tell the stories of our faith, because we're the successors of Christ, the apostles, and all those who have come before us in faith. Yours are the stories through which the world will come to learn about and believe in Jesus Christ. And each of us has something engaging to share, I'm sure. And in God's eyes, each of us has something important to share. So my friends, what is your story? Think about it this week. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us affirm our faith using the Nicene Creed.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of His Father before all worlds,
beseeching you to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit, truth, unity, and comfort. And grant that all those who do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word and live in unity and godly love. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops and other ministers, especially Justin, Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, our presiding bishop, Daniel, our bishop, Alistair, our priest, as well as Francis, Bishop of Rome, Bartholomew, Archbishop of Constantinople, and all other denominational leaders, that they may, both by their life and doctrine, set forth thy true and godly word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. And to all thy people give thy heavenly grace, especially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence, they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. We beseech thee also so to rule the hearts of those who bear the authority of government in this and every day, especially Joe, our president, Josh, our governor, John, our mayor, and all our local elected officials, that they may be led to wise decisions and right actions for the welfare and peace of the world. Open, O Lord, the eyes of all people to behold thy gracious hand in all thy works, that rejoicing in thy whole creation, they may honor thee with their substance and be faithful stewards of thy bounty. And we most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, the comfort and supper, the Bresco family, Lana, Bob, Isabella, Alexandra, Linda, Liz, Shauna, Tammy, Barbara, Maddie, Christine, Lucille, Rich, Andrew, Tom, Arthur, Jimmy, Pike, Clark, Jack, Walt, Veronica, Pamela, Cleta, Holly, Ron, Frank, Kathy, Laura, Blake, Cameron, Mark, Jerry, Rose, Jack, Trudy, Ruth, Art, Harriet, Mary, Lauren, Brian, Laura, Blake, Cameron, Scott, Sandy, Todd, Ray, Barb, Scott, Ryan, Karen, Louise, Marge, Mary, Matt, Brad, Dean, Veronica, Paul, Aubrey, Jim, Lewis, Brian, Jerry, Lee, Veronica, Pamela, Lynn, Joan, Ken, Harriet, Art, Kaizen, Fayum, Kaifeng, Bernadette, Alma, Sean, Faith, Brenda, Maria, Kathy, Mark, Jerry, Mark, Donna, Joyce Randolph, and all those who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. We give thanks and pray for those celebrating birthdays this week. Sylvia Johnson, Joel Ferret, Ty Logan, Ruth DeLong, Chrissa Smith. We give thanks and pray for those celebrating anniversaries this week. David and Mary Callahan, Michael and Jeannie Palmieri, James and Laura Jean Price. We pray for the children, teens, and college students of this parish, and for those serving in the military. We pray also for the life and witness of Huntington Parish, St. Mark's A&E Zion Church here in Newtown, and St. Paul's in Lebanon. Lord, look graciously on thy church, and so guide the minds of those who shall choose a rector for this parish, that we may receive a faithful pastor who will care for thy people and equip us for our ministries. We offer up any other prayers at this time, whether aloud or in our hearts.
For the victims of the wars in Ukraine and the Middle East.
And we also bless thy holy name for all thy servants departed in this life in thy faith and fear, especially Hector Hugh Wiz and Lucy Cummings and Christian martyrs throughout the world, beseeching thee to grant them continual growth in thy love and service, and to grant us grace so to follow the good examples of the Blessed Virgin Mary, Joseph, our most holy spouse, Ruth, our patron, and of all thy saints, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant these our prayers, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate.
Amen. Let us humbly confess our sins unto Almighty God. Almighty God,
Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and declare our manifold sins and wickedness, including from time to time as grievously we have committed, by thought, word, and deed, against thy divine majesty, promoting most just as thy wrath and indignation against us. We do earnest to repent, and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. Remember so that is forgiven unto us, the burden of the business is our soul. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve with thee.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all those who with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you with all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Hear the word of God to all who truly turn to him. Come unto me, all ye that travail and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, to the end that all that believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Please rise. Beloved, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And with thy spirit.
Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us as an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
will now continue with Eucharistic Prayer 1 with a source in 4. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto our Lord God. Should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, everlasting God. But chiefly are we bound to praise thee for the glorious resurrection of thy Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. For he is the very Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us, and hath taken away the sin of the world, who by his death hath destroyed death, and by his rising to life again hath won for us everlasting life. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, sins of the whole world, and in Institute, and in his holy gospel, command us to continue the perpetual memory of his precious death and sacrifice until his coming again. For in the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it, in remembrance of me." Wherefore, O Lord and Heavenly Father, according to the institution of thy dearly beloved Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, we, thy humble servants, to celebrate and make here before thy divine majesty, with these thy holy gifts which we now offer unto thee, the memorial thy Son hath commanded us to make, having in remembrance his blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, rendering unto thee most hearty thanks for the innumerable benefits procured unto us by the same. And we most humbly beseech thee, O merciful Father, to hear us, and of thy almighty goodness, vouchsafe to bless and sanctify, with thy word and Holy Spirit, these thy gifts and creatures of bread and wine, that we, receiving them according to thy Son, our Savior Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. And we earnestly desire thy fatherly goodness, mercifully to accept this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee to grant that, by the merits and death of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls, and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice unto thee, humbly beseeching thee, that we and all others who shall be partakers of this holy communion may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ, be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, and make one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him. And although we are unworthy through our manifold sins to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. By whom and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end.
Amen.
And now, as the Savior Christ hath taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory,
Lord, forever
and ever.
Amen.
Ave Lord.
do not presume to come
to this thy table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, and in thy manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather of the crumbs under thy table, but thou art the same Lord whose property is always without mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to be the flesh of thy dear Son Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us.
Amen.
The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Body of Christ, the bread of heaven, the blood of Christ, the bread of salvation.
Stand.
Let us pray. Almighty
and merciful God, we have been our thee, that thou hast seen us in the ministry, through the spirit of food and the will of our Father and God, our Son and our Savior Jesus Christ, and thus assure us thereby of thy favor and goodness towards us, and that we are bearing our mercy forward in the midst of the body of thy Son, the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of thine everlasting kingdom. And we humbly beseech thee, O Heavenly Father, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship, and do all such good works as thou hast prepared for us to walk in. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom we in the Holy Ghost, in all honor and glory, world without end.
First and foremost, Happy Mother's Day. Thank you. I'd like to wish all of our mothers and mother figures in our lives a very blessed day. And it's the tradition of our parish to give you a flower, our nation. So thank you for preparing those. So if you mother to children, to pets, to plants, so I'll be passing them out. So wonderful. Other announcements. Oh, coffee hour.
I just wanted to warmly welcome all of you to come next Sunday. We're doing a new mass that we've been preparing. It's a very ancient mass. It's the Missa Pange Lingua of Josquin des Prez. It's a beautiful Renaissance mass. And it's that along with for Trinity Sunday, we're doing one that you've heard a few times, the Mass of Three Voices by William Byrd. So we're going out with a bang for our choral season this year, and I hope that you all can come and bring your friends.
Wonderful. So, correction to the coffee hour. We can enjoy the flowers. And now the blessing. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in the knowledge and love of God, of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be upon you this day, and remain with you always.
Amen.
Oh,
love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God.